The topic of today is a topic that we could be, you know, having seminars after seminars about this, because it's a topic that is, in one sense, controversial, okay? Because what I'm trying to do today is to try to, from my own point of view, spell out what is the difference between the post-colonial and the decolonial. Okay? Let me first say that I'm not here, whatever critique I'm doing to the post-colonial literature, I don't want that to be taken as a negation to the contributions made by many authors under the post-colonial literature. Okay? I recognize the contributions of Edward Said. Orientalism is a book that we have all to read. Okay? This is a very important book we cannot avoid. So I'm not saying this out of kind of a negative critique to the work of the post-colonials. I think the post-colonials have done great work and we should engage it and acknowledge the contribution. The same with Gayatri Spivak and Omi Bhabha. I'm mentioning these names just because they are the names associated with this literature, but there are many other names, okay, that are usually also recognized in the literature, but usually also not named that much, that I want to name later in the conversation. But my comments here are going to be focused more on these three figures, Bhabha, Spivak, and Said, because they are the most known, and the post-colonial literature is associated with their work. They are seen as the foundation of this field, okay, called post-colonial studies or whatever. Okay? So, second thing is that my analysis here is not representative of any group. Okay, I'm talking for myself. Okay, I don't want people also to read my comment as, you know, I'm talking for Latin America or I'm talking for a particular group in Latin America or etc. You know, I don't want to be heard this way. You do know that this is my personal opinion, okay? And the third thing is that I also want to say that in my opinion, decolonial perspectives are very old, okay? I also don't want to present any kind of recent literature on decolonial as if it's the new trend or the new thing in town, okay, as another fact. I want to acknowledge that decoloniality exists since the time of that Columbus arrived to the Americas. I mean, you have already decoloniality there in the resistance struggles, in the critical thinking that was developed against colonizers all over the world, not just indigenous people in the Americas, but also Muslims in different parts of the world, Buddhists, Africans, you name it, okay? So decoloniality is not something invented by anybody or something recent. It's very old, okay? And it's been with us for centuries. It's just that because they are coming from the underside of modernity, usually we don't take them seriously. They're not read in academic circles. They're marginal to academic circles. Epistemic racism usually inferiorizes knowledge in relation to the white man, and so on, okay? So I just want to also put that out front to make it very clear that I'm not promoting any kind of, the new school of decoloniality or things like this, okay? Anybody who does that, I find it problematic. I find that as a way of colonizing, you know, a whole plural, diverse body of critique that have been going on for centuries. And I would like to say this to avoid, you know, this kind of readings. I don't want that to be anything I say here be understood that way. Okay, so let's begin with the question of similarities. Similarities are very, I think, very clear. It's a critique to Eurocentric narratives. I think if there's something that is shared by post-colonial literature with the decolonial perspective, is a critique to Eurocentric narratives. And this is something very clearly shared by almost everybody in the literature, okay? Now, I want to emphasize more on what is the difference, okay? Because although there are some similarities here and there, I think that in terms of the limited time we have, it's better to spend more time into the differences, because part of what happened is that what has happened in the last, I don't know, 20, 30 years of postcolonial literature is that the decolonial has become subsumed into the postcolonial, okay? And I also find that problematic, okay? Let's begin with the first difference. I think there is a difference with beginnings. Where do you begin the history of colonialism? This is very important, okay? And you will see the implications of this, okay? Let me also say before I continue with this is that now I'm giving you, usually people use decolonial and postcolonial as identities, and many intellectuals use it as an identity. Okay, I am in postcolonial study, or I'm doing decolonial perspective or study or whatever, you know? And I'm not going to use decolonial or postcolonial as identity. What I'm going to try to do is bring an analytical criteria for us to be able to distinguish the decolonial from the postcolonial. Once we do that, then the whole decolonial postcolonial falls apart, because I will say that there are people in the decolonial literature that are postcolonial, and I will say that people in the postcolonial are decolonial. You get the point? So I'm also advancing this ahead so that you also know that I'm not making here a binary, or I'm just bringing criteria that I think is fundamental to understand the difference between the two perspectives. according to my view, again. So I'm going to begin with some analytical criteria. First criteria, where do you begin? Okay. If you begin with the history of, let's say, like Spivak and Bawa, that they're centered fundamentally in the experience of British colonialism in India. Okay. If you begin there, we're talking about mid-18th century. Okay. We're talking about mid-18th century. If you begin with the what we call today on quote-unquote Middle East, okay? Like Said, with the word Orientalism, he begins somewhere there, you know, with the Napoleon arrival to Egypt in 1798, I believe. And then from then on, the whole colonial expansion, British, French, etc., into the colonization of, Middle Eastern land, Arab Muslim lands, okay? So he begins more into the 19th century. Okay? Now, these beginnings have theoretical, political, conceptual implications. Okay? The beginnings. In Latin America, we begin in 1492. Okay? That's where we begin the history. Okay? Now, here, these beginnings, I think, are very important to understand the emphasis or differences in these two literatures, okay? I think it's founded a lot on this beginning. Where do you trace the history of the beginnings of colonialism? So you have, on the one hand, you have, in the case, if you begin in the mid-18th century, or you begin in the 19th century, there is 300 years that are there before the British arrived to India, okay? There are 300 years before British and French arrived to, Arab Muslim lands, okay? So these 300 years are very important in terms of how are we going to conceptualize many things that I'm going to go over in detail now. These 300 years are constitutive of what happened in India, because it's not as if the British are right there in a tabula rasa, okay, like point zero of colonization. No, they arrived with an experience of colonization that was traced back to the Americas, okay? The same thing happened in Arab Muslim lands. decolonization was fundamental in the 19th century, all the way till beginning, you know, of the 20th century, with finally destroying the Ottoman Sultanate. You know, so so you have there a process of colonization that you could trace a beginning maybe in 1798 with Napoleon arriving to Egypt, and later expanding into many of Muslim Arab lands, etc., over the 19th century until finally the fall of the Ottoman Sultan. Okay? But this is already 300 something years after 1492. So that means usually what happens is that we begin the histories of colonialism according to where we are, you know, to our experience, no, the experience. And so the part of the problem with that is that we lose sight of these other 300 years that are fundamental for the understanding of methods of colonization, racist discourses, etc., that comes, you know, later in the history of colonial, European colonial expansion. And this is fundamental to know for the following reason. If you begin in 1850, let's put it, with the British colonization of India, and you don't look at these 300 years, okay? Is, or you begin in the 19th century, okay? It's very easy to fall into the following traps. Here we see conceptual implication. Let's begin with the conceptual implication. If you begin in mid-17th century, mid-18th century, or 19th century, then the perception is that, you know, colonialism is happening over here, and there is something that is happening inside Europe that is called the project of modernity, that is a critique to the ancient regimes in Europe, okay? And so this critique, you suddenly are looking at this critique as allies of your struggle against the same empire, okay? I don't know if it, so for example, you take the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment began before the British arrived to India. The Enlightenment began before the French and the British arrived to Arab Muslim lands. It began before. So what I'm trying to say is that, I mean, of course there were entrepots in India, entrepots, but the full colonization of these lands happened later, okay? So the entrepots were already there, late 15th century, early 16th century. You could see that in the history in Asia, okay? In India and other areas. But the full-blown colonization came later, okay? And so what happened is that it's very easy to fall into the traps of thinking that this internal critique to Europe is an emancipatory project, okay? You will see the internal critique to Europe as some people that are doing this critique, you know, and a kind of autonomously delink from the colonial process, okay? Kind of, okay, these people are attacking the ancient regimes, the monarchies that are colonizing us, okay? We lose sight of the limits of that critique, okay? And we fall into the trap of thinking that that project we call modernity is an emancipatory project because we're looking at it from the gaze of a beginning in the mid-17th century, you know, in the mid-18th century, I'm sorry, or in the 19th century, okay? But when you begin in 1492, the problem you face is that this internal critique to Europe is already embedded in white supremacy and in colonial, imperial projects. That, what I mean by that is that this internal critique, from the beginning in the 16th century, you begin there, what we call modernity is entangled with coloniality from the beginning. Okay? It's not something that you first have one and then the other. No, it's that they were all, the two together. The Renaissance was developed on the shoulders of the European colonial expansion. Okay, even though it began a little earlier, but it's developed in a strong way with the European colonial expansion, okay? And the European colonial expansion, I claim, and you could see my videos in one of my talks here before, began not just in the conquest of America, but in the conquest of Andalusia, way back into the 15th century. So, and the expansion of the Portuguese through Africa, okay, trying to get the shortest routes to India, okay? And then you have the beginning of the kidnapping of people in Africa to enslave them, etc. Then the Spaniards with the conquest of America took this local economy of slaves or more regional economy and make it global, okay, by kidnapping people in Africa and then transporting them to America to enslave them there. But the point is that when you begin this history from the point of view of the 1492, modernity and coloniality are two sides of the same coin. And therefore, modernity from the beginning, this internal critique to Europe, emancipatory critique to Europe, was a critique that was constructed along the lines of how to make the situation better for the European masses and people, but without questioning how the wealth was accumulated here. So in other words, this critique, with a few exceptions, there were a few exceptions to this, you know, we could mention a few of them that were doing this radical critique from Europe, but the majority of the thinkers were not thinking in terms of the links between the modernity project of critique inside Europe against the ancient regime and how they are leaving white privilege and the Western privilege on the shoulders of colonialism and slavery in the Americas, okay? So the point I'm trying to say is that if you lose sight of those 300 years, it's very easy then to fall into the traps of looking at modernity and coloniality as disentangled. And therefore, fall into the traps of having an enchanted view of modernity, an enchanted view of white man project. You look at this as some kind of emancipatory discourse. You lose sight that modernity from the beginning is not an emancipatory discourse. It might be for certain masses of people in Europe, but not for humanity, because it was based on the shoulders of colonizing and enslaving the rest of the world. Therefore, modernity from the beginning is poisoned by coloniality. You cannot delink the two. The privilege in terms of wealth, as well as rights, as well as citizenship, and so on, that came with the critique, this internal European critique of the Enlightenment, etc., science, you name it. All these things that were internal critiques inside Europe were tied from the beginning with the colonial project. And that's why when you examine all these Enlightenment critical thinkers, when you examine them carefully, all of them were racist. All of them were based on, you know, colonial mentality. All these philosophers were tied somewhere or another. Look at Hume, for example, tied with colonialism and slavery in the Caribbean. And I mean, you could look the ties between all these critical thinkers, etc., with the project of slavery and colonization in the rest of the world. So the point I'm trying to make is that if you disentangle and you start looking at the Enlightenment, all these critical thinkers within the West, from the gaze of mid-18th century and 19th century, you lose sight that these people, that the history of colonialism began 300 years before, and this critique, internal critique to Europe, is taken to a global stage, Athenian democracy. What do I mean by that? Okay, we're going now to celebrate and to demand an improvement in terms of rights, in terms of citizenship, in terms of wealth, in terms of, you know, inside Europe, but inside the walls of Europe. What I mean is that outside the walls, you will have the slaves and the colonial subjects who are going to be, you know, on their shoulder of all these people is where they're going to build their discourse, critical discourse, modernity, etc. That is, they're not linking their critique to the emancipation of colonial subjects and to the emancipation of humanity. They're thinking of emancipating themselves. This is a very problematic project. That means that the left discourse in the West is already embedded and grounded on colonialism and imperialism. This is a major, major problem. And this is very difficult to talk and have conversation about this with the white left, because they felt insulted when you say that. And they feel that you are kind of taking the rock out of their legs, you know, below their legs, you know, you're taking the rock away, and they don't know where to grab. Because if you look at all these critical thinkers, I'm not saying there's nothing we can learn from them. I'm not saying that, okay? I'm not falling into an obscurantism, an anti-European fundamentalism. I'm not saying that. There are things you can learn from some of these authors, of course, okay? I'm just saying that the project at the theoretical level, intellectual level, and political level was from the beginning poisoned. From the beginning, entangled. Modernity was entangled with coloniality, and you cannot disentangle that. And if you don't look at this entanglement, part of the way the West was successfully able to colonize people was to make them believe that this rise of the West was due to something special, that they have the intelligence, that they have the science, that they have the correct policies internal to Europe that made them improve, you see? Sui generis to Europe, you see? The moment you take that line of thought, as a colonized subject, you become enchanted with modernity and the white man. And here is where you have one of the major failures when you look at the Ottoman Sultanate in the 19th century, and when you look at Muslim lands, you have a lot of people, a lot of the reformists, for example, of the Muslim world, that were looking at Europe from the sides of the Mediterranean, but they forget the Atlantic. I don't know if you get what I mean. Mm-hmm. So if you look at it from the side of the Mediterranean, what you see is like, wow, these people are becoming very wealthy. They have all this science, technology, all this stuff, even though a lot of this science was stolen from Islamic civilization. But with colonialism, they destroyed that memory in the colonized. So now you have Muslims admiring Europeans, saying, wow, these people are moving, you know? We need to imitate this. We need to do something to catch up, okay? And now you have, inside the Muslim world, all this reformist discourse, like there's something wrong with being Muslim, okay? Something wrong with Islam. Something wrong with us that we have fallen behind. And they didn't see that with the Atlantic, as Enrique Dussel reminds the whole time, philosopher of liberation in Latin America, which by the way, I saw him in a debate with some Muslim intellectual, and it was funny because here is a Christian theologian telling the Muslim, there's nothing wrong with being Muslim. I mean, there's nothing wrong with you. Why are you looking at your theology? There's something very simple. The Atlantic, they brought all this silver and gold from the Atlantic and devalued the wealth. That created a devaluation of all the wealth of the Islamic civilization. Okay, and then with the blood of indigenous slaves in America, they built the naval boats that defeated the Ottomans in the Battle of Lepanto. Okay, that's how they did it. Now, if you lose sight of the Atlantic, you get enchanted with, wow, these people are, you know, they have something special, you know? They are developing all this wealth, all this science, all this thing. And then, next thing is they destroy your civilization by colonizing. And then they destroy the memory, because then they practice epistemicide, something I spoke last year here, you could see it online. They practice epistemicide, that is, they burn your libraries, they destroy your knowledge. Next thing, they are the ones telling you what happened and the history and everything, okay? And then you have people who begin the history of, okay, what happened to us, we Muslims? This happened not only in the Muslim world. This happened in the world. It happened all over in Africa, many places, where people kind of get stuck with the, you know, notion that the Europeans, you know, there's something special, okay? And this is where one of the first decolonial attitudes is to stop being enchanted with modernity. Because modernity is already poisoned with coloniality, okay? That's the first, I think, basic decolonial attitude. You need to understand that modernity and coloniality are two sides of the same coin, okay? This relates to questions of the whole modern secular move, okay? Local European history had a serious problem with developing science, philosophy, etc. Okay? Because Christian institutions were Christendom, okay? Ideology of Christianity becoming the ideology of the state, that is, I explained a lot of this in my talk last year, but the point is that Christendom was an obscurantist kind of structure that was forbidding the possibility for developing science, critical thought, philosophy, you name it, okay? So in the local history of Europe, in order for them to do science, they have to displace the authority and the power of the church because of the dualism of Christendom. Christendom established a dualism since Constantine in the fourth century, where with the Trinitarian Christianity, where they did split the world between the material world, that's evil, and a spiritual world. You know, the spiritual world are the goods. And this dualism was very instrumental for the Roman Empire, to many of the powers after the Romans, to make basically put the opposition or the critics on the side of evil and burn them alive, okay? So you're evil, you're with Satan, you are, you know, we have to get rid of you. This is the way they build their power, with this Manichaean structure. But this Manichaean structure impede the Christian European civilization to do science. At the time, science was developed in the Islamic civilization because in the Islamic civilization, there was not that dualism. There was the notion of unity, diversity within unity, you know, tawhid, no? And that allowed for the possibility of developing science without that being a threat to the Islamic sultanates, because you could find anything in the ecology of the planet, anything you discover is celebrated because it's just a creation of the same force, Allah, and therefore is scientists are celebrated to discover something new, okay, and it doesn't contradict anything, you know, with regard to that form of political authority. But in the Christian world, anything you discover that will go against the dogmas of the political power, then is a threat, okay? Because they were working under the notion of the dualism, okay, of material, spiritual world. In the notion of Tawhid, you know, it's a unity between the material and the spiritual, and therefore there's no problem if you discover something new with the spirituality. It's part of the same. It's a creation of Allah. So you, as a scientist, are celebrated when you discover something new that we didn't know, and as a creation of Allah. But in the Christian world, that was a threat. That was subversive. That was a major thing. That's why they burned scientists alive. Okay. So this is very important, because then what happened in local colonial history, in local European history, and that's part of the fallacies of Eurocentrism, is to take local European history and make it world history. Okay? And so they established this notion called religion, okay, that is already a colonial notion, and we repeat it a lot in our everyday language, which is this thing you do on Sundays. Okay? It's something you do on Sundays. Okay? As you know, and if you know the non-Western spirituality, that doesn't make any sense. Because in non-Western spirituality, the worshiping of the sacred is every day, it's not Sundays, you know, and then next day you do something different. This is, you know, so this is nonsense when you think about it from non-Western spirituality. So if in the West it was a problem to do science with spirituality because of this institution called the Christian Church that was practicing this obscurantist form of Trinitarian Christianity, if that was a problem there, what they do is now they're going to project that to the rest of the world, okay? Even though in the rest of the world, there was no problem between doing science and having metabolism in the spiritual era with no problem. I mean, the advance of science at the time in the late 15th century was elsewhere, was not in Europe, was elsewhere. The rest of the civilization had no problem between doing science and worshiping the sacred. Okay, there's no problem with that. But in Europe, it happened, it was a problem. So what did they do? Eurocentric thinking takes local European history and makes it world history. And what they do is then they project in all the other spirituality the concept of religion, okay? And the idea that religion is an obstacle to science and opium of humanity, okay? Remember this? So this is also part of the colonial project is then going to be to, even one moment of the colonial project was to impose Christianity, okay? And destroy other spiritualities. Later on, when the Europeans move away from the authority of knowledge in the church into a new religion called science, okay, with enlightenment, post-enlightenment period, then what they're going to do is, with this scientificist discourse, they're going to then go and colonize all these colonial subjects with the notion of modern secularism. And what they're going to do is to secularize Christian narrative into the modern nation state, because if you look at the Napoleonic laws or you look at all these laws, they're a lot based in Christian cosmology, okay, or the cosmology of Christendom. And what they do then is to then project on the others, okay, the notion that if you're Muslim, you are, that's religion and that's an obstacle to science. So you need to get rid of that. So what they're doing is a process of epistemicide and spiritualicide. They're destroying spiritualities and the knowledge attached to those spiritualities to colonize you better, okay? So part of what happened there is you begin in the 18th century, 19th century, it's very easy to fall into the trap of seeing this project of secularism as some kind of radical critique that we should embrace, you see? That we should embrace. Well, if you examine this from before, the Enlightenment was already a result of the Renaissance, and the Enlightenment was already embedded in racist premises, in slavery, in colonialism, you name it, okay? And so this critique from the left of Europe was already poisoned with coloniality, okay? And you could see the same thing when you moved into the 19th century, too, with Karl Marx. I mean, he was the most radical thinker at the time against the capitalist system. But then, when you read what he writes about people in the colonies and slaves, it's just Orientalism ABC, you know, Orientalism 101, okay? And that's what you get from Karl Marx, you know? And he even invented an Orientalist concept called a despotic Asiatic mode of production to give a material grounding to Hegel's concept of people without history. So what is a despotic Asiatic mode of production? It's a mode of production that never changed. It's cyclical. And the only way you can change these people is with an imperialist invasion. That's what Marx said. So you need, he supported the British invasion of India and the American invasion of northern Mexico. He supported it way, you know, straightforward with this concept that, you know, as a good Hegelian, people without history, and for them, the material grounding of people, what this mode of production he called it this way. But, anyway, so this is Orientalism. He bought all this Orientalism at the time, so you could see a lot of the racism coming out of this white left critique, which is, you know, I'm not saying there's nothing to learn from Marx. Please, there are things we can learn and we can use, but we need to decolonize these authors if we're going to make them useful to a project of liberation, okay, and to a project of decolonization. So why I'm going through all of this? I'm going through all of this because this, I see here a fundamental problem, and that is any postcolonial or decolonial theory that does not take white supremacy, racism, and the systemic violence suffered by bodies located in the zone of non-being as a point of departure of their theorization is just another recycle of colonial theory. I don't know if you follow me here. I repeat it. Any postcolonial or decolonial theory that does not take with white supremacy, racism, and the systemic violence suffered by bodies, human beings located in the zone of non-being, as a point of departure of their theorizing and their critique, is just a recycling of colonial theory. I mean, you could say, oh, I'm decolonial, postcolonial, but if you don't take this as your central framework from which you're theorizing is just another way of, you know, repeating colonial theory, now more perverse than before, because now they're going to represent the theory as something radical, decolonial, whatever, okay? Post-colonial, decolonial, whatever, you see? And so for me, this issue that modernity and coloniality are two sides of the same coin is a fundamental concept that we need to integrate into whatever we're doing, if we don't want to fall into the embellishing of modernity, okay? And what happened is that once the Iberian Peninsula went down after the 30-year war, okay, after the 30-year war in between the Dutch and the Spaniards in the 17th century, what happened is that after that war, the Iberian Peninsula gets displaced and inferiorized inside Europe. Okay, so all the categories, racial categories, the Iberian Peninsula, you know, transferred to the colonial subject in the 16th century. Remember, Iberian Peninsula began this process of colonial expansion from Europe. Then they get displaced because then the Dutch are going to come in and displace them, okay, from the center of this war economy created and this civilization created after 1492. And then later on, they're going to be, it's going to be the British, then the Americans, etc. But the point is that at that moment, when they inferiorized the Iberian Peninsula, and they kind of kick out the Iberian Peninsula from the picture, and then the new center goes to Northwestern Europe, okay? What happened there is that there is a process of a split inside Europe, and you have a process in which the new powers of Northern Europe are going to expel Spain from the history of modernity. They're going to begin now the history of modernity elsewhere. And they're going to create a narrative that will embellish modernity. I call it a process of embellishment, okay? Make modernity something beautiful and great, okay? In order to do that, you need to bury the 16th century and the Spanish and the Portuguese. Why? Because in the Spaniards and the Portuguese, when they were discussing all these things, they were overt about it. They were talking in an overt way, okay? They were not hiding anything. So suddenly you have the Dutch coming in now with the British, the French, etc. And now they come with, no, modernity begins in 1648 for the Dutch, okay? With the Treaty of Westphalia, where the Dutch become the new hegemon. And now the Spaniards are going to be seen like savages, etc., you know, no, these people, that happened in 16th century, had nothing to do with our project. We are civilized people, these people are uncivilized. They're going to repeat the same thing internal to Europe, you see, to the previous colonizers. So they're going, even though they learn everything from the Spaniards, because all of them, while the Spaniards and the Portuguese were moving and abroad to colonize lands, and so you see all this silver and gold coming in, the Dutch, the German, the French, the British, all of these people were looking at it and saying, what the hell is going on here? So they were all like, wow, what are these people doing? So they were all following in detail. And they sent what is called pirates that are today are CIA agents, you know? So the pirates of the time were the CIA agents of the empire. So they were sent over there to see, okay, what are these people doing? All this wealth coming here. And so they went there and they found, oh, this is what they're doing, you know? So then they joined the process, you know? And they became then the Dutch displaced the Spaniards and the Portuguese in the captive trade in Africa, you know? And so on, and then the British and then the others, you know? Everybody joined. So they learned the whole thing from there. All the racist theories, they learned it from the debate of Las Casas and Sepúlveda I have talked here before, people with a soul, people without a soul, etc. You know, then all these things, they learn it from there. But then what do? They carry over all the methods and all the conceptual, basic conceptions, but they will bury where all these things are coming from. And now they will put a new beginning in 1648 in the Treaty of Westphalia. And now they were going to represent and embellish modernity as some kind of emancipatory project relative to what the Spaniards and Portuguese were doing. And then you have later, if you ask French, they would put it in 1789, the French Revolution. This is where, you know, modernity and all these things came in, you know? And so on, I mean, and so you could see how each empire would put a different date after the 16th century to basically bury the history of the 16th century. That history, you need to bring it back to understand what's going on. You need to go from 1492, the conquest of Andalusia, and the conquest of America. You need to put these histories together to then see the relationship between modernity and coloniality and how they were able then from there to create a discourse of modernity as something embellished, beautiful, that everybody should embrace and that we should imitate, okay? Because in burying that history, then they're not going to talk overtly anymore, you see, in an overt way about the methods of how they became wealthy. You see, what they're going to do is then build new theories to say, oh no, we did it because we were hard, the Protestant ethics, you go over all the theories, are all theories to hide the darker side of modernity, which is coloniality. That's what they're doing, all these theories. So finally, the other thing is, so part of what happened, and this is one of the differences, is that for many post-colonial theories that begin the history in the 18th century and 19th century, they see modernity as something happening parallel to coloniality. And they see modernity, therefore, some kind of critical tool or critical process inside Europe, but unrelated to coloniality. But if you begin in 1492, you get a different picture, because you could see that how all these critical projects are already tied to questions of enslavement and colonization of the rest of the world. You see the point? So the beginnings is very important, okay? Because it could, in a sense, invisibilize certain things and visibilize others. So this is one of the problems that I see in many post-colonial theory, because one of the implications, there are two implications. One is epistemological, okay? If you begin that way and the darker side of modernity, you don't see it entangled with coloniality. You see modernity as an emancipatory project, not as a civilizational colonial racist project. Then the critical thinkers of that project are people you have to read, embrace, and use, and you see? And then the epistemic privilege of the white man of five countries that I spoke here in my previous talks that you could see online, which is what is privileged in westernized universities, always in all the disciplines, men, Western men of five countries, Italian, French, German, British, and Americans. This is what you read in any discipline you go, okay? And this is what is privileged, okay? And so white man of five countries become now the source of what is reality, what is truth, and what is good for you. These are so now they decide for you all these things. And they are the scientists, they are the superior knowledge, the rest are inferior. So you have epistemic racism, sexism. Okay? I call it racism, sexism, because it's the inferiorization of everybody else, all the knowledge coming from elsewhere, okay? And the inferiorization of all women, including women of the five countries that are not part of the canon. Despite the rhetoric that the West is the most emancipatory project for women, I'm sorry. But still today, if you look at Westernized University, you hardly see taken seriously the knowledge of women, even of the five countries. Not to talk now about African women, Caribbean women, Asian women, etc. Okay? But not even the women of the five countries are taken seriously as part of the canon of thought. Okay? So this is very important to keep in mind, because what is going to happen then is that in post-colonial theory, they don't see a problem in grounding their knowledge in Foucault, Lacan, Derrida, Marx, and Gramsci. These are the five authors that you're going to see in many of the post-colonial theory as the central authors that are going to be celebrated and used for what is called post-colonial studies. Where are the thinkers from the rest of the world?
Who are the five? Say again.
Lacan, Derrida, Foucault, Gramsci, and Marx. Okay? If you look at Said, it's fundamentally Gramsci and Foucault. If you look at Spivak, it's fundamentally Derrida and Marx. If you look at Baba, it's fundamentally Lacan. Okay? So I see a problem, and from the decolonial perspective, there is a problem there. Because you don't have their epistemic diversity. It's not that I'm not saying don't read these people. Please. Okay? these people have contribution to it, we can learn from them, but we need to understand their limits. Mm-hmm. And if we're going to use those theories, we need to decolonize this theory from their own Eurocentric gaze. If they're going to be useful for a liberation project. Otherwise, you just fall into, again, putting the white man again of the five countries as the authority of knowledge to again give up the theories now to decolonize and to criticize Eurocentrism. I'm sorry, but I see a limit to that if you don't embrace epistemic diversity. So from a decolonial perspective, not only you need to be critical of modernity, not only the decolonial attitude has to take seriously a skepticism towards white man and modernity as a first step to get out of the spell, okay, of this Eurocentric world, okay? But you also need to take seriously the critique, the epistemological decolonial part, which cannot be just based, again, in white man of five countries. Where is Kwame Nkrumah? Where is Sylvia Winter? Where is Sylvia Rivera-Cusicanqui? Where is Ali Shariati? Where is, I mean, we could go over the list. We know that there is a body of thinkers, male and women, okay, all over the world that have thought about critiques to the project of modernity from the experience of coloniality, you see? Because another thing is to criticize the project of modernity from modernity itself, from the interior. So it's a Eurocentric critique of Eurocentrism, you see? And so what I'm trying to say is that we need to, part of what happened with decolonial theories, first, the post-colonial theory, they don't begin in 1492, they begin later, and therefore the relation between modernity and coloniality is disentangled. They don't see modernity and coloniality as two sides of the same coin. Therefore, from there they jump to then take the critical thinkers of that modern project inside Europe as the fundamental only source of critical thinking. Only source of critical thinking, look what I'm saying. In that, they fall back into the trap of epistemic racism, sexism, which is the foundation of knowledge of the modern colonial world. They're not taking seriously Muslim critical thinkers, you know, indigenous critical thinkers, black critical thinkers, etc. This is out of the window, okay? And so here is a project that needs to be decolonized. If you take only those five authors as the only source, okay, and you don't do a work of decolonizing them from their own Eurocentric gaze, you're just going to repeat a colonial epistemology in the name of some kind of critique to Eurocentrism. Again, with this critique, I'm not saying there's nothing to learn. This Orientalism is a fantastic book. It's very important, okay? I'm not saying there's nothing to learn. I repeat that because I began with that, and I want to insist that there's a lot to learn from this author. But from a decolonial perspective, there are limits to the project the moment you only take those thinkers as the only source of critical thinkers. So you brought back the white man through the back door, okay? And so the other problem that I see is, so we're seeing the implication of the beginning for the concept of modern decoloniality, the relation between the two, for the concept of epistemology, okay? Because once you take modernity as a critical emancipatory project, then the thinkers could be also used as such, you know? But if you think of modernity as a civilizational, racist, colonial project, then you need to be careful with those authors, not in an obscurantist way, but try to see what is useful from what is not useful, because they never thought in their theories what it means to be a colonial subject, an indigenous person, black person, or, you know, a Muslim person in this white supremacist world. Okay? They never thought of that, okay? This is not in their gaze, because they're thinking from a particular experience in the world, okay? But the problem is not to say, oh, I think from a particular experience, oh, we all think from a particular experience. The problem is not that. The problem is that then they're going to sell their theories as universal. And they're going to say, you want to understand what happened to you in Africa, you need to read Marx, and you need to read this other and that other, you know? Otherwise, you don't understand anything. So they think of themselves, instead of saying our theories are based the particular experience of Europe, I cannot tell you what it means to be a slave over there because that's something I haven't theorized and haven't thought about. That would be more honest. I have no problem with that. But the problem is when they start selling you their theories, and that happened not only with the Marxists, but also with the westernized feminism. It happened also with the post-structuralist thinking, all this stuff. You get a lot of that, okay? Then the political implications is very very clear. If modernity is poisoned by coloniality, then we don't need plural modernities, more modernity, or postmodernity, because we know what it, modernity is already. I mean, we don't need more of that. It's already this disaster we're living. That's modernity, okay? So why do you want more modernity? Why do you want plural modernities? Why do you want, I mean, really, I always look at this as very problematic, and this happened a lot with the postcolonial literature. I see a lot in the postcolonial literature, what I call postcolonial literature, in my definition, using this criteria, I see very colonial. So postcolonialism, I wrote an essay, the title was that, Decolonizing Postcolonial Studies. Because postcolonial studies is very much colonial when you look at these things. So we need to decolonize this field because it's really poisoned by these problems, okay? And then part of the political implication is that from a decolonial perspective, we don't need more modernity. We need transmodernity, like Enrique Dussel would say, a beyond modernity, a beyond the white supremacist world we live. That's what we call modernity. When Europe became the center of the world, you know, and took power, colonized the rest, and put themselves on top, okay? Plundered the rest, enslaved the rest, colonized the rest. And then you come with an embellished narrative. Oh no, we did it, we were hard, we have the Protestant ethics, we have this, we have that, and then it makes sui generis the way Europe made it, you know? In fact, you could see in the history how linked is the process of the rights of the West with the plundering of the rest of the world. I mean, this, we don't need, you know, we can discuss that, but we don't need to go into too much detail, but the point is how the political implications that we need to go beyond modernity in the sense that we need to transcend this modern colonial racist, white supremacist world, and move into a world where many worlds are possible, which is the Zapatista slogan, a world where many worlds are possible. What does that entail? Taking seriously epistemic diversity. The transmodernity is taking seriously epistemic diversity to rethink everything that Eurocentric thinking kidnapped as if it was naturally inherently European. Concept of democracy. They have kidnapped that and now they recycle it as if it was something naturally of the European method. And so in doing that, what happened is that then they make up belief that all these things are coming from Europe, okay? Everything, human rights, liberation of women, you go over the list, okay? And in fact, what happens is that they are really, what they have done through the colonial process, appropriating the knowledge that they learned from other parts of the world and recycling it as something essentially, fundamentally European. So here you have a Eurocentric fundamentalism that is the one that names everybody as a fundamentalist, you see? And we never think of it as a fundamentalist. I call fundamentalist any epistemology that think of themselves as superior over the rest that practice epistemic racism, okay? And if you take that definition, Eurocentric perspective is the most fundamentalist of all the perspectives because they have the knowledge. They have the resources to impose their knowledge, but they also have the possibility of, they are the ones who have created all these other fundamentalisms that we call in the third world. They created it epistemically, okay? Why I'm saying that? If you examine everything we call fundamentalism, Afrocentric fundamentalism, Islamic fundamentalism, etc., you examine this, not all, because they will say everybody's a fundamentalist the moment you're thinking from another epistemology, so we need to take a distance from that. But there are some versions of fundamentalism. I call it Eurocentric inversions. There are variations of Eurocentrism, but all they have done is take the binary of the West and invert it like this. If the West say, the West is naturally inherently for woman liberation, the fundamentalist would say, no, there's no notion of woman liberation or anything in our perspective. That's a Western thing. And ours is superior to you, and they just do like this. Okay? Or they would say, if the West say, democracy is inherently and naturally European or Western. The rest of the world are naturally inherently authoritarian. Right? That's a binary, a Eurocentric binary. What is a fundamentalist doing? They just invert it and say, it's true, we are authoritarian, so what? We're superior to you. You know, and they're not looking at the history of how these are all narratives of the West after having still not only wealth, but knowledge. Who told you that the Greeks are Europeans or Western? That's a complete invention in the 17th, 18th century, because the Greeks, who have nothing to do with the West or what we call Europe after 1492, is a civilization that goes back and were highly influenced by the Egyptians. And the word democracy is not coming from the Greeks, it's coming, as Enrique Dussela demonstrated, from Egyptian language and from Egyptian structural practices of democracy. And what was Egypt at the time? It was black. It was African. Okay? So I'm saying this because we have the whole history completely upside down, because they mess up not only with our epistemologies, but also with the history. So you have today versions of Islam that are recycled around the world as if they were some kind of authentic Islam. Okay? So you have all these ISIS, Wahhabi, jihadist thing. It's just, you want to understand it? The press say, oh, these are medieval people, backward people. No, French Revolution, 1789. Check it out. These people are practicing exactly what the French were doing in the French Revolution. They were pushing for what? They were pushing for a nation state. No, one nation, one state. Anybody who is different, you cut their heads off.
That's right.
And that's what they're doing. This is the modern project of the nation state. And this is, and what is the method? Cut their heads.
That's right.
Well, look at the French Revolution if you want to understand ISIS. Okay? So, but this is the problem, that I give you a metaphor. I was recently in Morocco. I was, there in the mosque, I saw that signs that say, no Muslim cannot enter to the mosque. And I was like, what? I mean, what is this? Because I never saw that in my life. I mean, in other parts of the modern world, you know that a no Muslim can enter a mosque. There's no problem with that. I mean, in the times of the prophet, you could see the same thing. There's no problem with that. Now, suddenly you see their signs saying, yes, I was curious. I said, well, where is this coming from? I mean, what is this? Okay? A general of the French army, colonial army, okay, Mariscal Lyautey, passed a law forbidding the non-Muslim from entering the mosque. It was part of the divide and rule, it part of the colonial strategy, okay? So they passed that law in the 19th century. Then it becomes internalized in the culture, it becomes internalized, and now you have people citing false hadiths to tell you, hey, it's here, it's there, you know? Ah, look at this, it's set here, false hadiths, okay? I'm giving you this example as a metaphor of how deep is the problem of colonialism. We're still living with the consequences today, okay? How deep it is. What I'm trying to say is, as a metaphor, what I'm describing to you about this forbidding Muslim to entering mosque, is a metaphor of what happened in the theology, okay? In the theology, you also have this kind of internal battlewinds that are just inversion of Western binaries that now passes as some kind of authentic Islam or authentic Aymara or authentic Yoruba or whatever, okay? And you need, this is very, you know, this is, it's a mess when you look at this. Because then it requires the work of decolonization, a huge effort to go into the history and to go into the theology itself, into the sources and where, since when these things happen, since when this, you know, and so you go into Wahhabism, you know, and you look at Wahhabism in the early period, and then Wahhabism later with the British colonization of that part of the world, wow, there is, it becomes, this, you look at the methods of reading the Quran, is an imitation of the methods of reading the Bible of the fundamentalist Christian Protestant sects. It's a borrowing of that, okay? So I'm saying this because, yes, we can go back in history and see intolerance in all the civilization, all the progress, you could see all of that. But my God, what you see, the sharp shift between the before, during, and after colonialism is a sharp shift. It took all these things to another level, okay? And this is where the French and the British are implied, especially in the Muslim world, but you could see the same with the Spaniards in America, you could see that everywhere, okay? So we are now living the consequence of that history, which put us in a situation where the process of decolonization is a process that is a major task, okay, for us today, okay? And to finish, there are two more differences with the post-colonial. So as a political implication, we are proposing transmodernity, a project that transcends modernity. Right now, we live in a world where not all worlds are possible, or where only one world is possible. That's the world we live today. Only one world is possible. The Zapatistas realize we need to move into a world where many worlds are possible. Okay? That implies the recognition of epistemic diversity in a horizontal way, okay? Where now every epistemology can come back and take over the field, okay, and redefine all these things that the Europeans have kidnapped as if it was their own, and redefine in their own way. So you could have a process of women liberation from Islam, from Yoruba, from indigenous perspective, from etc. Who told you that the monopoly of women liberation is the hands of the Western women? And since when we have to think that Western women give you are the only one giving you the tools? I'm sorry, there's a thinking of women liberation way before the feminist, the Western feminists. And today, you know, that's another thing. We think that the beginning of that is the Western feminists, when in fact you could find traces of this way back in many cultures, okay? You could say the same thing about the question of human rights, the question of democracy, the question of economy, everything. And again, they are the ones telling you, you know, what is reality, what is true, and what is good for you. And so the thing is, the other difference that I can develop later is that in the post-colonial, they emphasize more on culture, and they kind of live outside the political economy. And in the decolonial, the idea is to put the two together. This thing about what comes first, culture or economy, these debates, is a chicken egg dilemma that you could find, you know, across the, you know, the Eurocentric debates. And we don't have to fall into those traps, because in reality, all these things are entangled and happening at the same time. We don't need to go into this debate, what conferred culture or economy. All of this comes together. And what we need are paradigms of decolonizing political economy, so we have a different cartography of power, like I presented last year, you know, et cetera, you know? So, and the other thing is the post of the post-colonial. The post of the post-colonial is problematic. There's no post to the colonial, okay? We live still in the structure of the colonial world, okay? So the post we need to put on the erasure, you know, and eliminate the post from there, okay? Now, having said this, let me finish by saying that if you use these criteria, you know, question about how do you see a relation between modernity and coloniality, questions about how do you see the question if modernity is a project of emancipation or a project of civilization, colonization, white supremacy. The question about the implication of epistemology, if the only epistemology in town is the white man of the five countries, or is there other epistemology to think, okay, critically about the world, okay? The question about the political implication, is what we need is more modernity, plural modernities, like many post-colonial would say, or we need to go beyond that. We don't need more modernity. Modernity is destroying the planet. Okay, it's destroying human beings, destroying life in the planet, human and non-human, okay? Once you go over these things, then I would say that this label, post-colonial, decolonial, is problematic. Because then I would say there are some thinkers in the decolonial side that I would place in the post-colonial side, in my definition. For example, Aníbal Quijano, who works on the concept of colonial power. But Aníbal Quijano do not recognize epistemic diversity. And for me, that's a fundamental question if you want to decolonize epistemology. And he's not taking that seriously in his work. So for me, this is someone who calls himself or is part recognized as a decolonial, not postcolonial, but epistemically speaking, he falls into what I call in my definition a postcolonial. And the same thing the other way around. Someone like Ella Shohat, for me, she calls herself post-colonial. For me, it's the colonial, because she begins in 1492. And she puts this at the center of European colonial expansion and the question of a radical critique to modernity and all of this, you know? So Ella Shohat, she calls herself post-colonial. I would place her in my definition as a decolonial. And the same thing you can say of people in the in the like another example could be Salman Sayyid, who has come here several times, that he used the identity of post-colonial, etc., but he also used the colonial, okay? And he's been working along, he thinks the post-colonial from a decolonial, you know? And he takes seriously the thinking also from, you know, Muslim thinkers, etc., in his work, you know? And so this is where I think that also the labels, the way people identify themselves should not be our way of understanding their work. It should be, we should have an analytical criteria to really understand the distinction between these two kinds of perspectives. Anyway, I stop here. Thank you.
You've got about 25 minutes for Q&A. Yes, I know. So, and I think there's going to be quite a lot. So if you can try and keep your comments and questions brief, and we'll get down to them. I'll take a few to begin with, and then we can also put together.
In your opinion, was the Haitian Revolution and the First War of Independence of India decolonial? The First War of Indian Independence, which was 1857, the Brits called it the Sepoy Mutiny, and the Haitian Revolution. The reason I ask that is I think, like the present Global South struggle, it has a tension and a contradiction of being decolonial to an extent and internalizing some elements of coloniality. So I wanted to kind of you to explore this tension and navigate that.
So a couple of author and some events that are modeled in our minds, how would you characterize
those?
First colonial decolonial.
Okay, the Haitian Revolution, I would say that I would call it a decolonial. Because the concept of equality, for example, of the French Revolution, was a fiasco. I mean, it was equality for the whites inside the walls of Europe. That's why I'm saying the period of modernity is poison from the beginning. They're taking all these concepts from the struggles elsewhere, you know, and from the colonization, and then they're bringing in, you know, because all the utopian thinking of the left in Europe, way back, from Utopia of Thomas More on, you know, you could see how they are reflecting on what they encounter in the colonial projects of the Americas. For example, they encounter in the Inca civilization collectivist societies that, you know, suddenly it is fertile for their critical thinking. But the problem is that they are building this critique on the shoulders of coloniality and enslavement, and therefore it becomes a prayer of emancipation for themselves. So it's already a colonial poison with coloniality, the whole left project inside the West, you know? And so the problem is that then something like the French Revolution, as C.L.R. James have very well demonstrated, is pushed beyond the boundaries of its limits by whom? By the Haitian Revolution, that was really taken seriously the question of equality. Did they meet Immanuel Kant for equality? I'm sorry. I mean, I hear this the whole time. Oh, they were influenced by the Enlightenment and Immanuel Kant. No, they were conservative of equality. It was already there in the slave revolutions of the Americas. It was already there way back. Okay? So liberty, freedom, fraternity, liberty, all these things of the French Revolution, it was already there and they didn't need Immanuel Kant for that, okay? They have their own traditional thought, indigenous, Muslim, you name it, you know, coming from Africa, coming from indigenous people in America, coming from Islamic, because as you know, many of the slaves were Muslims, you know, in America, of African slaves. And so all these things were already there. And so what happened is that then these revolutions in France, that was, again, internal critique, but they never extended that to the colonies or to the people and, you know, the slaves and stuff. What happened? Then the Haitian Revolution erupts and push the French Revolution beyond of what they were ready to accept, okay? So then the Haitian Revolution, finally, it's a long story. You can read C.L.R. James' Black Jacobins, and you could see there that they were facing all the empires. Why? Because they were encircled, because suddenly you have blacks taking power getting rid of the mantra was a very bad example for all the slave plantations around in the Americas. All the slaves were watching this, and it was encouraging the rebellion in the south of USA and all the Caribbean colonies, as well as Latin, South America. So all these things were happening, and but in the case of Haiti, I would say it's decolonial, because they are already also not thinking from within the paradigms of the West. They were building something different from their own perspectives, from indigenous perspective, from African perspective. I mean, for example, MacIntyre was a famous leader of against slavery there and against colonialism, who happened to be from Muslim origin, and he was already thinking from within that tradition. There were other thinking from Bantu, another thinking from Yoruba, etc. So that was a decolonial process. Problem was that the whole world, the whole imperial white supremacist world, got united to destroy. Okay? That's what happened. They destroyed to the point that they were forced to negotiate with the French, and the French told them, we allow you to have international trade only if you pay us what we lost as masters of slaves. And they were forced to pay them until the 1950s of the 20th century. Do you know that? 150 years paying the French for having get rid of the masters? I mean, this is amazing, no? And recently, in the late 1990s, when the French declared slavery a crime against humanity, then the Haitians came and said, okay, then reparations, where is the money? Okay, you have to pay for this. At least the minimum thing you can do is return the equivalent of the money we were paying for 150 years, and it was several billion dollars, okay? And guess what? They sent Chirac, sent Regis Debray, a guy from the white left, you know, to Haiti to see if it was a good demand or not. Regis Debray came back, did a report, and said, no way, we're not going to pay for that, okay? So this is an example, okay, of how all these things were crushed, okay? So I would say the Haitian Revolution is an example of a decolonial revolution, epistemically, politically, from all points of view. But it was very early destroyed by the empires, okay? And then you have the invasion of the US in the 20th century, you know, from 1915, occupying until 1934. Because part of the decolonization was also decolonizing the racial hierarchies, where the black people were not now under the rule of the brown people, you see? Of the lighter skilled blacks, which happened in most of the other islands in the Caribbean. So here they democratized the whole thing. But what happened? The Americans invaded and brought back the browns on top of the blacks. Okay? And that is until today. So anyway, this was destroyed. Okay? And then in terms of this, the work on Occidentosis, no? You say, how do you say it in English? Occidentosis. I think this is a fantastic word in terms that I recommend people to read, because, I mean, from a Muslim Islamic perspective, you know, talking about the toxicity, okay, of Western epistemology and Western thinking, okay, using the metaphor of being toxic, no, Occidental toxic. But this Occidental toxic is talking exactly about what I've been talking here. When you are enchanted by white man epistemology, white man modernity, okay, and you think that this is going to this is something we have to imitate, and then you are toxic with this kind of, which is another way of saying, okay, you've been colonized if you start believing those things, which is what happened in most of the world, not only Muslim world, in all the third world countries, you have this problem, because they destroy our memory in many ways. They went after the epistemologies and the spirituality and twist them with all these, colonial binaries and things like that. And now, you know, the problem is that you end up thinking that there's something, you know, that they're doing that we're not doing, or we have to catch up and that kind of thing. The moment you fall into that trap, you are in Occidentosis, right? You are already, with the sickness of this Western centric view. You know, this is, I think this word is very useful and very important. I mean, as you could see also in Latin America equivalents to this word, you know, that we're already also doing critique to colonial colonial mentality, colonial mind, colonization of the mind.
How come the European countries managed to colonize all the world, most of the world, without knowing the language, the culture, or the geography of those countries, while the other countries don't do it the other way around?
Colonial. So the question is along the following lines. Is it possible that decolonial scholars who appear to be, anyway, those who claim to be committed to a decolonial project, but who make use of tools developed by Europeans within bodies of thought such as post-structuralist theory, post-modern theory, anti-foundationalist ideas, that they actually end up becoming appropriated and ensnared and entrapped by those very frameworks? And is this a form of kind of tacit self-orientalism? In other words, they're so enchanted by these tools, even though they think they're using them for liberatory decolonial projects, but the tools carry so much weight with them that they actually end up reproducing the very structures that they're supposed to be struggling against.
Maybe we can begin by your question in the sense that there's no the project of decolonization at the level of education, first of all, in my work, I talk about the westernized university. For me, we need to change the language. We have to put names to everything, because if not, we fall into the traps of the language of power. We say the university, we think that this is a neutral space, that is giving you objective knowledge and so on. No, this is a westernized university. Call it the way it is. And the epistemology of the westernized university is Eurocentric fundamentalism. And it's a Eurocentric fundamentalism, but they are epistemically racist, sexist. And they privilege white men of five countries. We need to call things the way they are. Otherwise, we get confused with the same language of power. Okay? So we need to create also our own language to talk about these things. Okay? So we make visible what they're trying to be invisibilized. Okay? So, in the process of, in terms of education, I don't think that inside, let's put it this way, inside the white westernized university, I call it westernized, it's not just Western. I say westernized because after 500 years of European colonial expansion, today that's a global structure of power of the global system, of Western civilization. To create the westernized elites everywhere in the third world today. So you have the westernized university, you could find it in Dakar, in New Delhi, in Rio de Janeiro, in Paris, London, or New York. It doesn't matter where you go. You enter a classroom in sociology or you enter a classroom in anthropology, you read the same guys. It doesn't matter what part of the world you are. So that's why I call it westernized university. It's a global structure of power that is part of the machine of epistemicide, of destruction of knowledge, destruction of memory, and creation of hierarchies of power and knowledge that are colonial and Eurocentric everywhere, and creating the westernized elites that are going to run the show, okay, everywhere. So for me, the Western University is a fundamentally rotten project, okay? Now, the problem we have now is that how do you go about production of knowledge, okay? That becomes, let's put it this way, alternative to this kind of production of knowledge. Alternative, from alterity, not from alternative. Here there are different paths, and this different path requires, you need to look the context, etc. I'm not saying this is the way or that is the way. But for example, I come from a department of ethnic studies that was created through strikes of people of color in 1969. That was one path, okay? So people went on strike and demanded to the white university space for autonomous thinking and having intellectuals of the movements being there as professors, okay? Bringing the narrative of liberation, going, taking our epistemology seriously and so on, okay? There was another strike in 99 to be able to keep the department going, because in the 30 years, 69-99, they were cutting off all the positions of professors. Those who pass away, those who transfer or retire, they won't replace them. So suddenly the department was shrinking almost to disappear. And there was another strike of students, you know, of color, you know, African American, Native Americans, Asian American, and Latinos, and conquer another, you know, 12, 15 lines, okay? So that's how this department have been surviving over the years. Now, their problems and their contradiction and their struggles inside that space, because there are many ways of colonizing space. But another path is what indigenous people have been doing in many other parts of the world, which is, okay, goodbye white westernized university, we're going to create our own university. We cannot continue inside those structures, because those structures are so colonized and so that there's no way, not even a strike, we don't want to achieve anything. Let's move away from that and create something different on the side. So that's another strategy. For example, the project of the Islamic Human Rights Commission here, of the producing knowledge at the service of the community and the liberation of the community, is another example of a way to think about production of knowledge that is alternative to this Eurocentric thinking, okay? And these structures that are already poisoned with colonialism. So, for example, it's amazing that these people have all the resources, okay, to expose and reveal the problems that are of the modern colonial world, and they don't do it. They just are participants of the concealment. They're participants of the erasure, the invisibility of the problem. It requires Islamic Human Rights Commission to do all this research, empirical research, to demonstrate the problems that people are living, racist problems that people are living, Islamophobia, etc. You know, so there, this is another path. Create our own institutional knowledge production. Okay, that's another path of decolonization. So I cannot tell you a priori is this part of that path. I cannot tell you that because it all depends a lot on context, and there are other places where there was, let's say, some kind of revolution or whatever that allows you to enter there into the ministries of education and open a debate and maybe push the country to move in a different direction. That's another context, very different, okay, from being totally disempowered from outside, okay? That's another one, okay, that could be another path of decolonization. So we need to look always at context, okay, to be able to say, okay, what is better in certain contexts, okay? And so I don't wanna a priori say it's this way or that way, but definitely I can tell you that, and I will agree that this, the Westernized University is rotten, okay? Westernized University, and the Westernized left is rotten too. I mean, the problem is that Western left, Westernized University, which fall into the same epistemology of, you know, white men, critical thinkers of the West, with all the reproducing the racism, enchantment with modernity, and everything else, you know. The problem is that they are in terminal crisis. This opens space of opportunity for the rest of the world. I'm saying terminal crisis because they cannot find solutions to the problem of humanity. The first line of this colonialism, MSSR, the teacher of Frantz Fanon, is a civilization that cannot find solutions to the problem it creates is a decadent civilization. A civilization that cannot find solution to the problem they create is a decadent civilization. And this is what is happening now. From the right or from the left, every time they come with a solution, it becomes a global nightmare. A global nightmare. They cannot tell you how to solve the problem they have created. Now, where are the solutions coming? From the global south and the epistemologies of the south. That's where the solutions are coming. But what happened? Epistemic racism and Eurocentric fundamentalism will resist till the end, okay, to not allow these other epistemologies to come in, okay, into the picture. They wanna keep the white man telling you what is good for you, okay? And this, all, you know, this is the structure we wanna keep. That's why for a decolonial project, so fundamental the question of disenchantment with modernity and disenchantment with the white man, okay? Because the moment you're enchanted with that, forget it. You are entrapped into the whole systemic way of thinking. Okay. Now, coming to the question of anti-foundationalism that you were mentioning, it depends. I mean, there are people who use all these theories. I mean, decolonization, in you could do work of decolonizing the Western critical authors. Okay? You could do that kind of work. I know people doing that, and they do fantastic work. Okay? The problem, there is a limit to that. And the limit is that you could, if you stay decolonizing Foucault or Marx, when are you going to have time to read Fanon? There's no time to read Fanon or no time to read anybody else. You see, this is why I'm not anti that. I think there are people doing fantastic work on decolonizing this author and showing the limit, all this stuff, you know? So I think this is, we should look at it in a complementary way. In a complementary, if we understand that that's not the only path of decolonization, that there have to be also people dedicating time and work for the authors that have been buried by Western modernity and the white man. Okay? Those authors have to be taken seriously. And if you're only decolonizing Marx and Foucault, then you never arrive to read Fanon, to read Kwame Nkrumah, to read Ali Chariati, or to read Silvia Rivera Cusicanqui, or anybody else. Okay? So this is where I'm saying epistemic diversity. That means, okay, some people might be doing that, and they're good at doing that, and these are allies in the struggle, and they're decolonizing the authors of the West. This is good, but we have to also, it cannot stay there. We have to go beyond that in terms of bringing epistemic diversity and taking seriously those thinkers that have been thinking from the underside of modernity, okay? And from coloniality. So these thinkers have to be also taken seriously. So I'm not promoting an anti-European fundamentalism. That would be silly. That would be doing to the European white men, okay, what they have done to the rest of the world. And if you do that, you're just inverting the binary of the West. You see, you're now putting the European man as inferior and the other as superior, and then you haven't moved beyond. You're just inverting the binaries of the West. If you want to displace the binary of the West, we need to go beyond this thing. And yes, some of these other critical thinkers of the West, we can read them, but with a critical eye, a decolonial eye, cannot be taken, you know, as such the way they are, because for a decolonial project of liberation, you need to do a work of, going beyond the limits of this country. You never thought what it means to be in a situation of the zone of non-being, okay? Be that in the south inside the north or the south of the north. They haven't thought of that, you know? So for that, you need other authors and other body of work, okay? So in that sense, we need epistemic diversity, okay, to embrace all these things. And so for me, someone who is doing anti-foundation and taking some of the authors of the world, but at the same time embracing, other authors and other thinkers, is no problem. I mean, I see it as complementary, you know? I imagine that when you say anti-foundation, I thought that maybe you're referring to Salman work.
That's as an example.
Yeah.
I have concerns with this because of the asymmetries of power of the discourses. And the point I was trying to make is not, it wasn't against using them, but it was the fact that they're very seductive. There's a kind of seductive power embedded in those discourses.
Yeah, but I always say, Salman uses post-structuralism, anti-foundationalism, all of that, but he also uses Imam Khomeini. He also uses Al-Shariate. He also uses all the other thinkers. So I always say, I wish all the post-structuralists would be doing with post-structuralism what you're doing with these authors, you see? The majority of these authors, they take post-structuralism and they take it to another planet, you see? And what Salman is doing in his work, I think, is a decolonial move. You know, so he's using this author and using other authors, embracing epistemic diversity, but doing a decolonial twist to the whole discussion. So where Salman arrives, Ernesto Laclau will have never imagined. I mean, he must be, to see the kind of thing he's doing with Laclau, or with other authors, post-structuring authors, is something that the post-structuring themselves would have never done. you see? So look at the word Osama in relation to his interpretation of the Islamic revolution in Iran, okay? To his interpretation of Imam Khomeini, his interpretation of the of Kemalism, how Kemalism was it. Now tell me one post-structuralist thinker that is doing this. Tell me one of the anti-foundationalist literature doing what Salman is doing with this. You see what I mean? So I think this, that we have to be careful also. Of course, if you only do that and you are just, you know, entrapped there and don't take seriously other experiences and other epistemologies, yes, you end up being an anti-foundationalist, Eurocentric, you know, repeating epistemic race. Yes, that could happen. But I don't think this is the case of Salman. I don't think this is a case of Salman. And if you see his latest book, Recalling the Caliphate, this is a very interesting intervention to the contemporary debates. If the book is here in the bookstore, I invite you to purchase it. Also, his fundamental fear is here. I invite you to purchase it. So, embracing epistemic teaching methodology, I think that the question of methodology and education is a major challenge. I mentioned already some of the path, but I think it's also the question about how the pedagogies that we have embraced are Cartesian pedagogies. Islamic traditional pedagogy, indigenous traditional pedagogy, all these other forms of pedagogy, you have an epistemic racism coming in, and then you have an inferiorization of the other pedagogies. And we're only with the Cartesian pedagogy, you see, as the only possible and plausible tool to do education these days, you see? And what about the other traditions of pedagogy? These are completely inferiorized to the Western Cartesian model, okay? So this is something we need to impregnate our spaces, institutional spaces, of also pedagogical diversity, you see? From this point of view. And we need to impregnate everything of this, bringing other knowledges into the picture to decenter the West, you see, and to dismantle the West, to put in evidence the kind of exclusion they're doing, you see, without falling into some kind of obscurantism, anti-European obscurantism. Because after all, there's a political project behind this, okay? And the political project is to say, after all, the West didn't do anything different from what the Muslims did, from what the Romans did, from what the Greeks did, from the Chinese did. And then suddenly we're talking this way. Chinese Empire, Ottoman Empire, Aztec Empire, Inca Empire, everything is an empire. But we never say British Sultanate, French Sultanate, Spanish Sultanate, Portuguese Sultanate. I see people laughing. We laugh when we say the other way because we see how nonsensical is what we're saying. But that's what we're doing when we say, Inca Empire, Aztec Empire, Ottoman Empire, we call empire everything that have moved since Adam and Eve. You get the point? We don't laugh because that's our present common sense, is that everything is empire. And this has been there forever. Slavery was there in the Muslims, slavery was there in the Roman, slavery was there and everything is slavery, okay? No. Decolonization also implies to historicize what the structures that we're living, okay? What that means that you need to understand that the West have done a tremendous work to make us believe that everything we're living today is the same since Adam and Eve. The moment you take that line as well, you make it universal. The moment you make it universal, it's transhistorical. The moment it's transhistoric is what you said, human nature. And the moment it's human nature, there's nothing you can do about it except make sure you're above and the rest are below you. That's the law of the jungle, okay? That's the law of the jungle. So the point I'm trying to make is that if you're rigorous, if you have rigorosity historically speaking, you need to understand that what we call slavery in the Muslim world, and I'm not defending any form of slavery, but let me say that what we call slavery in the Muslim world had nothing to do with modern colonial slavery, with chattel slavery, nothing to do. First, because it was not racial. Second, because slaves had rights, and you have many sultans that were born slaves and ended up being the sultan. How did that happen? Well, that never could have been imagined that someone who is slave in the Americas, born slave, will be, you know, in the same moment of slavery, the president of France or something like that, okay? So I'm saying this, that's why everybody was shocked by the election of Obama, because it was almost impossible in the West to imagine that, okay? Second, the notion of nation state is a thing that happened recently. Before, all these other forms of political authority were not nation states. That did not exist. They were organized in a completely different way. You could have people from the periphery of these states that were in the leads there, okay? Today, that's difficult to imagine. We think that the Ottomans are an empire like the Romans and the French, and we think that the Chinese, no, the Ottomans were a sultanate. The Chinese were a lineage. The Aztec, I mean, we could go over each of them. These are complete different forms of political structure that you cannot collapse in the idea that, oh, this is all the same. The same with slavery. Slavery is not the same, modern chattel slavery, with what happened in the Greeks, with what happened with the Romans. These are complete different, or with the Muslim, you know, complete different logics and complete different social systems and civilizations. You cannot collapse the world like that, like everything is human nature, and it's the same forever, okay? The other thing is the category of colonialism. Colonialism is very difficult to use the term colonialism in many of these political structures, like the Ottoman Sultanate, or like the, et cetera. You go into the pre-modern forms of political authority, and there is a major shift in 1492, and that has to do with the question of what Nelson Manuel Torres calls a metaphysical catastrophe, which is when people start being perceived as animals. As animals. That did not, with all the conflicts, I don't want to romanticize the past, so all the conflict that existed in the past, even massacres and all of that, that discussion, if people have a soul or not, is people are animal. That's a modern colonial discussion. That's not pre-modern. It didn't exist elsewhere, okay? So we need to historicize all of this, not to fall into the traps of thinking that what we're living today is just a continuation of everything everybody has done. After all, the West didn't do anything different from the rest. They just continue. That's why they went to Africa and purchased slaves. You know, all they did was to purchase the slaves. You see, because there was slavery already in Africa. I'm sorry, you kidnap free people in Africa and then enslave them in America. That's a complete different story. It's not a slave trade, it's a captive trade. That's what was going on. So these things, we need to name them, we need to understand the discontinuities in history, to understand what kind of social power and what kind of forms of coloniality exist in the civilization that killed more human beings than any other in the world. This civilization has destroyed forms of life like no other in the world, human and non-human, to the point we don't know if we'll be alive 100 years from now. We don't know which species will survive Western civilization. We don't know. It's a question mark, you know, because it's a civilization of death. This is how indigenous people talk about this Western civilization. It's a civilization of death, okay? Because it has destroyed the habitat of the planet. This didn't exist before. With all the critics we can do, with all the other civilizations, there was no destruction like you have in this one, okay? There was no, because what happened was that the West stole wealth, but stole knowledge. And in the stealing of science from the Islamic civilization, what did they do? They steal the science, they steal the technology, and live on the side spirituality. Now, you live on the side spirituality, you have a science without spirituality. You have a sign without spirituality, you have a sign without ethics. You have a sign without ethics, then you have a sign of death, because you have no limits. You can now, you can create now, anything goes with science today. There's no limits because it's a sign, spirituality was left behind. That's what they did, the West. During the time of Islamic civilization, there were limits to how far you can go because there was an ethics, a spirituality, etc., that in a sense put certain limits of science project. You're not going now to create, you know, how do you say, soap to, you know, with human fat, okay, or you know, that kind of thing. The the industrialization of death, you know, this is what we have today. You know, in many ways, not only in industrial military complex, but also in terms of the food we eat, in terms of all kinds of stuff. This is very ingrained in Western civilization. This is not human nature. I'm sorry. The concept of nature, for example, that concept of nature did not exist before. This concept of nature we have today is destructive of life. Why? Because the concept of nature is really putting the following thing. Nature is exterior to the human. This is the dualism of the card. It's exterior to the human, okay? Nature is inner object, life in, on the side of the human, and then nature is a means towards an end. With that perspective, every technology you build with that rationality have the system structure of life. Because you are all, you are seeing yourself outside. Nature is all forms of life that are non-human, inner objects, and then a means towards an end. That's, capitalism doesn't have to be that way. You could have had a form of capitalism with another understanding of how to go about producing technology. But capitalism and technology are not neutral to Western civilization and Western epistemology. And what happens if you build a technology that has the notion of Tahiti or the notion of Pachamama, okay, of the indigenous Andean indigenous, that have a notion of unity? It's a different notion. Then you understand that we are not, there's no nature. That's a Western-centric concept. What you have is a cosmos, and we are all within. And therefore, this is not a means towards an end. This is an end in itself. So with that rationality, you can build a technology that is not destructive of life, but have the seeds and the rationality of reproduction of life. That didn't exist before. This existed before. This new form of thinking about nature and the dualism with that, that is destructive of life and life in the planet, is a Western civilization of the last 500 years. This didn't exist before. So be careful with this naturalizing the structure of the present and naturalizing our ways of thinking and acting and the present structure as if it was human nature, because this is the quintessential Western-centric ideology. They don't want to say that it's the West that has destroyed all this. They want to say human nature. It's the humans. We are humans destroying life. We're very, you know, very bad. No, it's Western civilization. Tell me which other civilization have done this. The others one have more respect towards life with all the problems that we can criticize of the past. I don't want to romanticize the past, but you don't have this destruction that you have to do. So that's why modernity is a civilization of death, like indigenous people call it, you know? And so anyway.